Hey, what's going on, everybody? This is Captain Hook, Tree Climbing. Thank you so much for tuning in today. In this video, we're going to be taking down this red oak. And as you see there, there's a little car there. We have that as a target, and it's just got a pretty good lead towards the house. So we didn't want to just go ahead and fell it. What we're going to do is just piece it down and then fell the stick. So let's go ahead and roll that intro and we'll get right into the video. Alright, so let's dive right into an alternating lanyard technique here, and then as we go up the tree, just gonna clear a little path by pulling off some of the trunk suckers there. So the third time's always a charm. There it is. If only it happened the first time. So I'm going to come off that lower D lanyard, going to alternate into that upper D lanyard there, and the coast is clear. So I'm going to start moving up the tree now. And as we come up to this thicker trunk sprout right here, what I want to do is just alternate over it with my lanyards, because it's just going to be, and I want to play around with it too much. And notice how I brought in that lower D lanyard in between my upper D lanyard. So I didn't bring it around, I brought it in between. So that makes switching off on and off of this system real easy and streamlined. And I have another union to pass here, and so right here I'll go over it, but whenever I'm gonna alternate from my upper D lanyard to my lower D lanyard, always bring the lower D lanyard through the center of that upper D lanyard there. You see? Yep. So it's isolated. Alright, so now I came up into the tree with a spar anchor set up. So that loop right there is made with Bolin and Yosemite finish. Take the ring off, rack it. And so I initially threw my tail over that side, but then I saw how the tail was gonna be on the back side, and I'm like, no, I'm not gonna be climbing out that way. I'm gonna be climbing out this way, where I'm putting in the direction of my tail right now. Yeah, so I'm gonna be climbing this direction behind me, because that's where the other lead is at. So yeah, this rope planning is so important to tree climbing. Alright, so as I'm choosing the length here on my rope, I want to just make sure that I leave enough room for a redirect, because I do expect to make a redirect on that back lead there. Go ahead and tie that alpine, and so the quickie, I always install it this way in order to make sure that the flat side stays on the bark. Think of it as the flat side is the bark side. flat sides of bark side, just like that. So I capture my working line first, and then I capture the loop on the alpine butterfly, and it just makes it very simple for me to attach it without having to worry about, like, you know, is that protruding pin gonna be up against the bark, whatever. Now, I did see a comment where somebody, they said, well, I've never heard of a quickie failing or anything like that. And I'm not saying that it will fail if you put it on against, if you put that pin towards the bark. I'm not saying that. That's probably not ever going to happen. But that protruding pin is the weakest part of the tool. It's the weakest part. So you want to just best practice and make sure that that thing is away from the bark. Flat sides on the bark. You got nothing to worry about. This thing is, it's bulletproof. So yeah, I understand that it is bulletproof and it's extremely strong. But yeah, best practices, man. Johnny's in that tree, diagonally across from me there, in the orange. He blew that top out of that. That was like half the tree. There's no bypassing it. This is a critical cut, so whenever the cut has to be very precise, I don't mess around with the bypass. And yeah, that came out well. So like that cut right there had bypass in it, but it doesn't really matter. So this, that hinge there, I shouldn't have held on to that hinge too long. I should have cut through the hinge a little bit quicker, because as you guys saw there, the tip kind of folded in too far, and so the butt end landed a little too close to that car. A little too close. But it turned out good anyway. Yeah.
Still, tie on the rope. Tie on the rope.
So that's Mike right there. So I'm getting to that critical point where now that I'm out on this branch here, I'm gonna require a redirect because I'm climbing up too close to my anchor point, my canopy anchor on the other side. So it kind of puts me at a right angle to it, and in case you need a bomb out or anything like that, it's just you're gonna go into that pendulum swing and you catch a lot of speed on it, pretty much, is what I'm getting at. You can get hurt. If you need a bomber. So, yeah. So what I'm going to do here is just, I'm going to clear out whatever I can on the left side of this lead here, and then since it curves out to the right over the car, I'm going to use a rope to pull that top out. So what I was going to do right here with that rope, I was pulling out slack so I can just make a bowline on a bite there for a redirect. But I realized that I'm trying something new and I have this bandolier type thing with me. So it's basically a long rigging loop. It's about, I don't know, 30 inches long, 35 inches long, and clipped on to it is a carabiner. Then I just make a quick redirect. So it makes a redirect real simple, real easy. But it's not retrievable. I mean, and neither is the bowline on the bite, but bowline on the bite doesn't require any extra hardware. So what I want to do with this top here, since it's curved up over the car there, and on top of that there's trees underneath it, I want to just pull everything out. And I'm going to pull small pieces out. These are small tops here. And so it's much easier for my guys on the ground to pull a small top than to sit there and try to pull some enormous piece out of the tree. And then on top of that we have a car underneath us, and mind you, it's like it's a brand new Kia, it looked like. So right there, I tied the rope off to the branch there, kind of like when you spike a rope so it doesn't fall through the pulley, and then you can have enough line to say tie up your half hitch with bowline on a negative rig. So yeah, that was kind of the idea with that one. Perfect shot, man. Perfect shot. And I had my doubts about that one. I didn't think that I would have made that one on the first shot. It was just, the position was precarious. A little weird there. The wind is blowing pretty rough. And I have a branch right in front of me that's just dying to catch the rope I'm throwing. You know what I mean? So I was really surprised I got that on the first shot. So I'm going to take out my makeshift spike there. Make sure these guys can pull this top out. And they got plenty of leverage there. Plenty of leverage. So right now I'm just trying to line them up with the same angle that this branch is on. That way they can pull directly against it and then it just folds right over, because that top was pretty laid out. It was laid out. I mean, if you're going to pull against the lean, that right there is a lean. It's always cutting like butter, man. So I cut a big wedge out of that. That's a massive notch. Right, so that turned out all very well. And so here I'm just going to show you guys just a little bit of what you can do with a double lanyard, beyond just diminishing a lag in safety and all that kind of stuff. So when you're passing unions, right? So here, the beauty of the double lanyard is that I can use it to help position myself exactly where I want to be. And even further than that is, not only can you just place yourself exactly where you want to be, but using the double lanyards puts different points, pulls your harness in different ways. So you got your main line, right? You've got your climbing line, and then you got two lanyards that are pulling on your harness in different directions, and it just keeps you really comfortable in the tree. Being comfortable in the tree kind of amounts to being comfortable in the tree amounts to you just being able to work very easily. And when you're working out on branches like this, man, it's great. And that was a long one. That branch right there was really long. Had to have been like a good 15-foot branch I'm throwing there. So, yeah, that double lanyard helps out a lot. And I think this is like, I think when I first started using that bandolier, I ended up using that bandolier so much more after that. Because I kind of realized, like, hey, you know what? Not only is it, you know, good here, but it's kind of just good to have any time in the tree for anything. If you need, like, a makeshift redirect for, I don't know,
one second.
For
hold it right there.
Your own climbing line in a base tie situation. And I do have a video on that. I'll try to link it in the description or even in the video where I'm able to slack my base tie and then move that base tie out of the way so I can cut the branch right next to it. You know what I mean? And it just works great. That this thing is a great tool. All right, so I'm gonna just piggytail over back to the other side. That loop isn't gonna get caught up, and it did, you see? It's terrible. You can't have it all, man. Literally. There's that figure eight. Handy, man. So handy. Always take a figure eight with me. And here goes the double rings. Those are my babies. I have them on me all the time. Anytime I'm climbing, I know I'm going to be rigging down logs, tops, whatever it is. Got double rings with me. And so the double rings, when you're installing them, you kind of want to attach them in a way that when you load it, it's going to cinch down on itself. What I'm doing here with my climbing line now is I'm putting my anchor point below my rigging point so that, you know, if this rigging point were to break, which is highly unlikely here, that the rigging point won't take my climbing line with it, you know, because if it was above the rigging point, it would go with it. If it was below it, it might not. So that's the thinking there. A little weird, but yeah, that's the way I was taught. So we're gonna install this rigging line now. Yeah, and you saw that quickie there. When I readjusted that climbing line tying point, I didn't make sure that that protruding pin was off of the bark. It's definitely against the bark right now. So, yeah, I mean, it'll hold, but I mean, I'm here today to tell you it'll hold, but the best practice is not to leave it that way. So yeah, I'm very particular about how I like to tie my knots, and I always like to tie them this way. I take the tail and I throw it with my right hand over to my left hand, and then I make my knot. Yeah, I'm very particular about it because I like to lay the knot in a certain way so it lays nice and flat. It's real easy for the ground guys to just undo it. Oh yeah, so you see how I just racked my saw there? That is one of the most useful things ever, because you can rack your saw like that. Say you're blowing out a top and you know you're about to go for a ride. You can just rack your saw on the side handle and it'll just stay. But it only happens with certain carry tools. With the kilo, I forget what... the Camp Kilo, it's called. So the Camp Kilo is a type of carry tool. I'm pretty sure you guys have seen the DMM Volts. Those guys, their gate is not big enough to hold your saw. I mean, it might lay there, but the gate won't close on it. You know what I mean? So if you were shaken up enough, it might just come out because there's nothing securing it. The gate on the carry tool just, it won't close. It's not wide enough. But the Camp Kilo is, that's the one that does it for me. And yeah, I do speak from experience because I've used them both. And also, just to bring that point even further, but from a different, you know, anyway, it's cheaper. The Camp Kilo costs like $40. It's just like a no-brainer. Like, why wouldn't you just buy the Camp Kilo? It'll hold your saw. It'll hold it by that thicker part on the handle, on the side handle. And the DMM Volt costs like $60, maybe $70 nowadays, with the way things are going. So, you know, I would definitely go with that Camp Kilo. That's some good roping right there, man. Good roping. Alright, so watch this. The rope runner, it's just gonna slide up the rope with zero resistance. It's amazing. All I do is clip it onto my chest harness, and all I have to do is focus on my hand and spike position. Make sure that I don't spike any of my ropes, and the rope burner helps me do that. Not spike any of my ropes, because I can focus on that. I don't have to be focusing on tending slack, none of that. The rope burner just self-tends. So I just like put a little piggy tail on it, because I was scared that it might slip out, because I got a short tail in there. Yeah, I was gonna toss the rings, but decided not to. And so you see there, the quickie was up against that that protruding end of the pin. But all went well, and now we're gonna switch over to a spar anchor. So you hear that wind, that day was pretty strong. I would say it was like good 20 to 30 mile per hour wind gusts. So when I'm making my spar anchor, throw that ring on there first. And here I'm gonna tie a figure eight on a bite. Tie, dress, and set. Make sure this knot is pretty. Gotta pretty it up here. So, I mean, it looks okay, but yeah. Now it's perfect. Yeah, let me just put that bird on there first, because we're gonna need that bird on there if we want to repel on this. So no alternating lanyard here. Just gonna go ahead and install that spar anchor once and for all. Get ready for my next cut. So you throw that loop around, put that loop through the ring, and then you capture the loop with a carabiner.
Should I come down further or right here? Right here? At the bottom. Word.
Yeah, so I just wanted to see, kind of see, check in with my ground guys. Always asking questions, man, because, I mean, if you have a team, you use the team. You don't, I mean, you can just make any decision on your own, but if you got your team there, man, why not? So this log is about to be, it's just enormous. It's huge. I don't know. I would say it's between 15 to 20 foot, and diameter wise at that point, it's probably about 8 to 10 inches. So we're double lanyard in. One lanyard per stem there, plus we're going to make a hard tie in there with the climbing system.
Ahí, ahí lo tiramos.
Ahí se va solo.
Sale pues. ¿Qué lo vas a tirar aquí?
Míralo ahí,
cut it here. Yeah, probably not. See, if we're gonna drop it that way, no.
Go ahead and give this an open face here. So what I should have done here instead of that open face notch there would have been a Humboldt. The Humboldt notch is much better for this, because what you're going to see is the tip of this log, it's going to spike the lawn there. It's going to be a little lawn dart, well, a giant lawn dart. But yeah, the Humboldt, you know, in retrospect, Humboldt would have been a better choice. That's what you call a lawn dart right there. Yep. And it came out good. I think I got a video of Mike felling this stick here on my Instagram. so I'm just trying to figure out if that's going to be too tight for me to DRT on. So yeah, I'm going to go down with a double rope technique with a moving rope system, I should say. So I'm going to form a moving rope system here real quick, and I just wanted to make sure that the crotch wasn't going to be too tight for me to, you know, when I get down on the ground, I need to pull my rope out, and I didn't want it to give me any trouble. So making sure before I come down on it is, you know, that's how I do it, man. Always check. Alright guys, well, this is the end of the video. Thank you so much if you made it to this point. Make sure you smash that like button. And if you haven't subscribed already and you like the content you've seen so far, if not, go ahead and watch some more of my videos and hit that subscribe button. Till next time, y'all. Peace out.